Today we are talking with Dr. Bruce Locke. He is the chair of our chemical and biomedical engineering department and also a professor at the college. And he's going to be talking about his research and how his career has developed in chemical engineering. So this would be a great topic for those of you who aren't quite sure what you're going to do with your engineering degree or even what's possible. So there's a couple things I want to go over first, some housekeeping items. Let's see if I can figure out how to do this. Here we go. We're glad that everyone is here. Please keep your microphone muted during the presentation. At the end, we'll have a Q&A portion. And excuse me while I admit people. Consider keeping your video off until you ask a question or speak. We also encourage you to use the chat function in Zoom to ask those questions as they come up. That way you can ask your question and it will be on the table. And at the very end, after Dr. Locke's presentation, I will answer those I will ask them of Dr. Locke in the order that they were received. So we make sure that we get everybody, all the questions answered. And I just want to remind everybody finally that this video feed and the chat are being recorded and they are going to be made available online. So Dr. Locke, I am going to stop share and allow you to take over at this point.
Okay, thank you very much. And is my screen showing now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. Well, welcome everybody. Before I start talking about some of my background, I do want to say a few things about our department, the Department of Chemical and Biomedical Engineering, and some opportunities for research with our faculty members. So as the title implies, we have biomedical engineers, and we have a number of faculty who work in imaging, bioimaging, particularly using NMR, and MRI, mostly at the NIAG lab, but we also have equipment in the College of Engineering. We have faculty who work in cellular and tissue engineering, and we have faculty who work in the biomaterials area. We actually have 22 faculty members in our department, and four are teaching only, and the others are our research faculty. And we have faculty who work in more of chemical and biomedical type materials, a lot of work in polymers, and a lot of work in complex fluids, and some in electronic materials. We also have faculty who do a lot of studies in nanomaterials, nanoparticles, and some of the kind of core chemical engineering areas include catalysis, chemical reaction engineering, which I'll talk a little bit about, a special topic of that of my interest, and energy and battery topics as well. So these are the general areas that our faculty work in. I also just want to bring your attention to the opportunities in the department for the undergraduate research program. So you can see the web page link. You can get to it from the departmental homepage, and there's a process for applying for undergraduate research program. Now, currently, Dr. Yan Li is the director of that program, and she administrates the various activities in terms of the honors in the major, the URP guidelines, and these things. So these are some details. If you're interested in finding out more, you can look on the webpage, and we'll be glad to answer questions. We also have on that webpage, and I won't go through all of this here, there are specific topics that some of the faculty members have listed in terms of areas that they are interested in recruiting students in. And you can see all of those. I won't read them here. You can go online and look at the different ones. They generally fall within the categories of the topics I mentioned on the very first slide. You can see quite a range of activities. One thing I am going to comment a little bit, a caveat a little bit, I'm not necessarily recruiting a student to work in my lab. I right now have four undergraduate students working in my lab. I think they're almost all juniors now. One of the things I might be interested in a student maybe next year as a junior, but I don't really have space in my lab right now. But a lot of the faculty members that like I'm listing here have interest in students. And some take students early on, some prefer students who are juniors. We can talk about that later if you have questions. So I'm going to kind of give a little bit of flavor of my own personal experience that can give you some, maybe just give you some ideas about how a career develops. So I went to school in Maryland, and I was really excited by the topics of math and science. I particularly had excellent teachers in chemistry and calculus, and those courses really steered me into the direction of chemical engineering. While at the time I didn't know what chemical engineering was, I liked the idea of applying math more to chemistry than a normal chemist would. So that kind of turned me on to chemical engineering. I also had a lot of work experience in high school and junior high. I did have a job where I worked at the Department of Agriculture, the United States Department of Agriculture, where I was a lab technician and I purified a plant hormone, which we extracted from the seeds of a plant. So it was a long, laborious process to go from extracting the material and then doing all kinds of purification steps. So that kind of taught me a little bit about some of the basic separation processes, which if you're all chemical engineers, you might study. I have a bachelor's degree in engineering, and I also have a double major in environmental and water resources engineering. I was very interested in environmental applications of chemical engineering. And at the same time, I spent a lot of time in my undergraduate as a leader of our student group, which was the environmental group. We actually ran a recycling center for the entire campus and made money on that. So in those days, aluminum and newspapers were quite valuable. And during my undergraduate years, I spent a semester at the Oak Ridge National Laboratory. And in that developed into my senior research topic, which I pretty much developed on my own. I brought it back with me from Oak Ridge. And at Oak Ridge, I worked on the removal of uranium, soluble uranium from solution by its adsorption onto the surface of bacteria and yeast. And it's actually a topic still under study up to this date in terms of how metals, in particular such metals, will adsorb to surfaces of microbes. But that was quite interesting to me, and I developed it into my senior research project. I also have experience working at Exxon Research and Development, where in those days I was writing computer programs that were used to design columns for removing carbon dioxide from a gas or gas separation processes. So I went on to graduate school at the University of Houston, where if you're all interested about master's degree and the difference between master's and PhD, I did a lot of coursework, particularly in math and computational areas. I also did my master's thesis in mathematical modeling. And then after my master's degree, I went to work. And during the course of my work, I became a professional engineer. I got my license, but I worked at a research institute in North Carolina. And my main focus of research there was on measurements of very fine sub-nanometer size aerosol particles, which were of very big importance in microelectronics processing. So we also did field studies to clean up groundwater at various military bases, where we used a process called air stripping, which really takes a volatile component from the liquid and puts it into the gas and then adsorbs it onto a carbon. So we were cleaning up groundwater sites, mostly up in Michigan. And my PhD work I did at North Carolina State, and there was also in chemical engineering. I did both experimental and computational theoretical modeling of the experiments I did. So that gave me kind of a background in both doing experiments And with my experience in working, I also had a lot more hands-on than I just got in my master's. I joined the College of Engineering in 1989. It was very small at that time. My first class that I taught was six. We had six seniors at that time. The college was actually established in 1982, and the first few students started to graduate a few years later. And by the time I arrived, well, we had six students. We only have five faculty members as well. And most of the classes I taught at that time were chemical reactor design, that's a senior class, and then several electives, including one in bioengineering. I also started my research in the college, where I was doing, building upon my PhD work and my skills in mathematical modeling. But I started a new area, which I'll be talking about a little bit more, which involves what we call plasma reactors. In the mid to late 90s, I was an associate professor. Our class sizes grew a lot during the 90s, up to almost 60. And then it came back down again. And only in about 2012 or 13 did the numbers start to rise again. I did a lot of work with the mag lab and MRI as well, transport and tissue. I started collaboration with biology professors at FSU in analyzing muscle metabolism and reactions in muscle. And I continued my work in plasma reactors. Another thing I wanted to mention that is very, for me, was very interesting and was all the international collaboration I was able to develop over the years. So starting about 1999, I had a sabbatical in Japan, and I got to go work there for a semester and really got to appreciate the experience. Also, not only was it an experience in terms of international, but I was working with electrical engineers. So I was doing more interdisciplinary work with electrical engineers in Japan. Since 1999, I've been a professor, and I've been teaching many courses, mostly involving transport phenomena, which for those of you who are just starting out, that really means things like fluid mechanics and the transport of energy, thermal energy, and mass. And I taught almost every one of our undergraduate transport classes, although I haven't taught in a while, the undergraduate class. And I've been probably teaching close to 20 years the graduate transport, although now I'm switching to the graduate math class. During that time, we started a major within the chemical engineering degree, which was biomedical engineering. I'll say a little bit about that later. But I continued my research. I started to work with Professor Teng Ma, who was one of the very first faculty we hired in the biomedical area, who did tissue engineering. And I used my chemical engineering skills in terms of modeling and analysis to help him in designing and analyzing the various reactors used to grow human cells. I continued a collaboration with international groups, going to France, China, Japan, and the Czech Republic for collaboration. And during 8 years of that time, I was the chair of the department, and I hired 10 of the 10 faculty members during that time. I also spent some time as associate provost at FSU, where I was working mostly on international activities and experiences for students. I also worked on university policy and hiring of faculty. During the 2015 to 16, I was an interim dean in the college, and I helped manage the renovations, a lot of the renovations that occurred inside the building. And I came back to the department in 2018, but on the unfortunate passing of our previous chair, Dr. Teng Ma, I took on the job as department chair again, starting in the fall of 2019. And this is also during the time where we're just beginning the implementation of the biomedical engineering degree. So now our department has grown to, like I mentioned, 22 faculty members, over 400 undergraduates, depending upon how you count all the pre-engineering students, and over 50 graduate students. So I've seen a lot of change in the college over the years. I also would like to mention to, for those of you who are interested in research as an undergraduate, that it can be very beneficial in your career development. So for example, one of my students who graduated in the late 90s, Sherry Stabler, she went on to do her PhD at Georgia Tech, and she graduated with me with honors as an undergraduate student. And now she's a professor at University of Florida in biomedical engineering. Another student, Mike Kirkpatrick, he actually did both honors and he stayed all the way for his PhD at FSU. And it was an interesting story because after his PhD, I asked him if he wanted to do a postdoc in Paris. And he said, sure, why not? And so I had a colleague there who wanted to bring him in, and they liked him so much that he's still, now he's a professor there teaching in French and enjoying living in Paris. So he grew up in Pensacola. So he had never actually left the US much. Another one of my students is now a professor at University of Michigan in the College of Medicine. He does MRI and doing very well. He also had some international experiences. One of my PhD students, Dr. Selma Thagard, is now a professor at Clarkson University. But other of my undergraduate students who did honors, Mark Bacchus, he's now a senior manager at Toyota in Michigan. And Mr. Jason Maxwell, also an honors undergraduate major. These are honors in the major. They all did research with me as undergraduates. He's now vice president at Kamen Performance Materials in Georgia. They make zeolites. So over the years, I've had over 60 undergraduate research projects, 34 graduate students supervised, and I've been on a lot of committees for PhD and master's students in chemistry, physics, biology, biomedical, chemical, civil, and mechanical engineering. And I've been on committees for students in different countries, including Belgium, the Netherlands, India, and Canada. So now I'm going to switch and just talk about one of my research projects and hopefully just kind of give you an idea of what we're doing. And I have a title here, it's fairly long, but you'll see why as I go. But we're interested in making nitrogen fertilizer in an environmentally friendly way. And we'll say more about what that means. But also another theme here, in addition to all the international collaborations I've had, this is also kind of a combination of chemical and electrical engineering with chemistry and physics as well. But with the overall goal really of what we could call electrifying the chemical industry. So you can see, you'll see that as we proceed. So first question, I don't know if there's any way to have anybody answer questions or there's any kind of interaction here, but I usually start this one with asking if anybody knows what's in common between these two pictures. And you can see on the one side, this is a lightning storm over the sea. And you can see lightning and water. But here you have a plant. That's called a legume, a pea plant. I don't know if anybody out there could tell me what's common between those two. Maybe nobody has an idea. But this is a lightning storm over water, and this is a bean plant. So what do they have in common? So there's a lot of things they don't have in common. One is the temperature of this lightning is about 50,000 Kelvin. That's pretty hot. It has very high current, 30 kiloamps, and those lightning strikes go very fast, 100,000 kilometers per second. And of course, the plant, it functions at ambient temperature and pressure. So what could they possibly have in common? Well, maybe as the title of my talk indicated, that there's something to do with this molecule nitrogen. So nitrogen is a very stable compound, and it's very hard to take nitrogen, and we need it in our food and our biological components. So I removed a lot of background slides here, but this is just to give you an idea. It's very hard to break apart and to make it something useful. Large amount of energy is required to split in two. And that energy can come from different ways. Heat can be direct collisions with high energy species like electrons. It can be disassociated by photons too. So you can see the energy level of nitrogen and then splitting it, it takes 940 kilojoules per mole. And you can see then also there's forms of nitrogen, for example, NO, which is called nitric oxide, that the nitrogen will combine with oxygen to make NO. NO is generally a pollutant, but we'll say a little bit more later about that. So both of those require energy to split oxygen and nitrogen, and then they recombine to make NO. So we'll come back to the answer to the question about them. You might think that in a lightning storm, you can have energy, high energy, that can split oxygen and nitrogen to make NO. But the bean plant is also able to take nitrogen from the air and make it, by what we say, bioavailable. So here's just kind of a summary of different forms of nitrogen. You probably are all aware of this from your basic chemistry classes, but you can start with N2, and you can see a more reduced form in ammonia, and then in organic forms of nitrogen. And you can see more oxidized forms where you've combined with oxygen. So the one I mentioned previously was NO, nitric oxide, which is a gas. But you also can lead to the formation of nitrite, which is an ion, water soluble, NO2, which is also a pollutant, and nitrate, which is a soluble form of nitrogen. Most plants, the best, most bioavailable form of nitrogen for most plants is this one, nitrate here. It's really important in growth of plants, and that's important for fertilizer. But also ammonia is used by plants directly in protein synthesis. So, well, why is all this interesting? So for example, back in 1903, there were some scientists, engineers in Norway who developed a electric arc process in a reactor, basically a large scale reactor, to split nitrogen and oxygen and make NO. And this process has a very high temperature. You're starting a little bit lower than the lightning that I showed before, that 50,000 Kelvin, but 10 to 20,000 Kelvin. And they have a process where the gases flow in and it passes by an arc, this high temperature arc, and then out flows the NO. And afterwards, the NO is combined in a different reactor with oxygen to make NO2. And then the NO2 is combined with water to make nitric acid. And the NO3 from the nitric acid was used as fertilizer. So there were very large plants. And in the time, this was done in Norway, where there was a lot of hydroelectric power, which made it feasible to do with large energy. It was an energy intensive process. Well, a few years later, the German scientists came up with another process for synthesizing ammonia. And this is then, instead of oxidizing the N into NO3, like the last slide, this is actually a reduction process. But you can see in a reduction process, you have to have hydrogen. So they had to have a source of hydrogen to cause this reaction to occur. Now, this is called a Haber-Bosch process, and it's now one of the most extensively used commercial processes for making fertilizer. And the ammonia production requires a catalytic reactor at high temperature. This is about 700 Kelvin and high pressure, about 200 atmospheres. And they use a catalyst to cause this reaction to occur. And it also has hydrogen, which is coming from natural gas. So there's a large CO2 emissions to make hydrogen from natural gas. But you can see over the years, this was introduced in the beginning of the 20th century. This is the Birkeland ID process in the beginning of the 20th century. Haber-Bosch was really becoming more commercialized a few years later, even though it was invented around 1909. It was more extensively developed. And over the years, it actually, you can see how this energy cost had dropped significantly during those years. But what's really interesting to look at is about the middle of the 20th century in the 1950s. This is when the Haber-Prosch process really became highly economical, and the production of fertilizer started to grow almost exponentially at the very beginning. So you can see this area around 1950s was critical area. And in the next slide, you can see how that affects the world population. So this is the world population in synthetic nitrogen production. And that same period of around 1950 is where the world population really started to go significantly above where it would have been if there was no synthetic fertilizer. And so this is the production of, this is a world population increase by the addition of synthetic fertilizer. You can see it basically doubling by now. It has a doubling the population of the world. So synthetic nitrogen is supporting roughly 50% of the world's population. Now, it's not just the growth of that curve was not just the growth of the nitrogen curve is not just due to the population growth itself, but if you look at per capita use of nitrogen, it also significantly increased. And the reason for that is that people want more rich foods to eat, more proteins and high meat foods. So the per capita production of nitrogen also dramatically increased, not only the total. These projections all kind of depend on what's going to happen. And you can see this graph is a little bit dated back to 2010, but there's the projections about increased amounts here all depend upon efficiency improvements and what the world population is going to do. So why are these issues? Well, first of all, the Haber-Bosch process uses 3 to 5% of the world's natural gas. And that produces a lot of carbon dioxide. And it also uses 1 to 2% of the world energy. The Haber-Bosch process is only efficient at very large scale. So you have to make a big factory to make it, and you have to transport those chemicals around the world. And one of the things, if you saw recently, where there was a huge explosion in Lebanon, and this is not the first time that it's happened, but the ammonium nitrate fertilizer that was stored there was the key component in the explosion that happened. So when you make the ammonium nitrate fertilizer in very large amounts and ship it around, it's a very dangerous compound. It's basically also what's used for explosives. So anyway, the Haber-Bosch process, like I was mentioning, is producing almost half of the nitrogen that's used in the world. There's also another source of nitrogen coming from combustion. There's a lot of waste. So you can see that huge amount of nitrogen per year that's wasted throughout the world. The amount that's actually incorporated in food is much lower. So in addition to those problems, the production of nitrogen, use of nitrogen fertilizers causes other greenhouse gases like N2O, nitrous oxide, which is a greenhouse gas. 75% of the nitrogen created on land now, coming on the land, is created by human purposes. And that causes a lot of problems. So if you're from Florida, you might recognize there's algae blooms, red tides. All of these things come from excess nitrogen washing away from fertilizers into the sea and as well as our fresh water. So as the world population grows, we'll still need food production will need to increase, and we'll need to have more efficient processes that don't affect the environment so well. So now to the research side. So that's kind of the background of the problem, why we're doing what we're doing. And the research side is why I come back to this picture, this lightning picture over water, is can we be inspired by nature to make a reactor? So here's a picture of our plasma over water, and I'll talk some more as we go. So first of all, since I know probably most of you don't know what plasma is, so when you take a material and you start to heat it, you can go from liquid to gas. And as you continue to heat it, you can take that gas and what we say ionize it. So for example, this is a phase diagram that you will study in thermo, but basically we talk about pressure temperature diagram. And if you take a compound, even at constant pressure, you raise it up from a solid to a vapor to plasma, high enough temperature, you can create a plasma. So the atoms become decomposed into charged particles. There's a mixture of particles, including these free charged particles, ions, and they're effectively electrically neutral. The overall system is neutral. But back in 1927, Irving Langmuir, who is a very famous Nobel Prize winning chemist, he coined the term plasma to describe this ionized gas. And for those of you who are interested in biology, you know that also we use the word plasma for our blood, the components in our blood. And that came first, actually. The use of plasma as an ionized gas came after the use of plasma in the blood. And it was Irving Langmuir who coined that terminology in analogy to blood plasma with red and white blood cells. Now, just as a kind of a reference point, we're going to talk about some plasmas. And there are two important properties of plasma we want to talk about. One is temperature. And there are lots of natural occurring plasmas, including, like I already showed, the lightning, but there's also stars and interstellar matter and even arcs. So we'll talk about that a little bit. So here's kind of a phase diagram of different types of plasma where we plotted the temperature, and you can see a very huge range from close to ambient conditions here up to 10 to the 8th in Kelvin. But the other property here, instead of, let's say, density, we're talking about electron density, so the amount of charged electrons that are present. And what we have here, so the key properties are this electron density, the background plasma gas temperature, and another one I'll show in a minute is the electron temperature. But you can see different types of plasma, the aurora here, the sun here. You can see even fusion reactors, very high temperature, very high electron density. But there's another classification of plasma where we talk about the temperature, or equivalently the energy of the electrons relative to the ions and basically the plasma. So in lightning and fusion reactors and arc, if you've ever seen an arc welder, these are what we call thermal plasma, where essentially all the species have the same temperature or energy. But for chemical reactors, we use what we call non-thermal plasma, and they're more akin to like a neon light or a fluorescent light bulb, or even this aurora borealis, or the wind, the solar wind. These are non-thermal plasma where the electron temperature is much bigger than the rest. So you're putting the energy in the electrons to cause reactions and minimizing the amount of heat. That's an important point in terms of any kind of reactor. So what you can see, so here's just for reference, what clean air would be. There are ions in the clean air that we have now, just the air that we're breathing. There's about 10 to the 9th ions background gas per cubic meter. And this is basically the reference point we'll talk about. Now, how do you make a plasma? So we talk about the natural plasmas, but you can make a plasma by applying energy of different types. It can be electromagnetic energy, ionizing radiation. It can be just charged particles, charged beams, like electron beams. You can also make by using high electric fields. And that's what we're going to focus on. You can do alternating current, direct current, pulse discharge, radio frequency, or even microwave. So these make a whole variety of different types of plasma processes. Now, just to kind of give you a little bit of flavor about how it works. So if you were to apply a voltage across a gap in a gas, like the air that we live in. As you increase the voltage, the current will rise, so the measured current. And this is basically Ohm's law. But at some point, because the air is limited in the amount of ions, you have this background amount of ions. At some point, you can't increase the current anymore with that voltage because the ions are finite. You'll start to reach a limit in current. Now, as you continue to increase the voltage more, you reach a point where the energy of the electrons is high enough, it can cause a dissociation or ejection of another electron from one of those species. So for example, electron colliding with species A can produce another electron. So that means one gives two, two give four, four give eight. So it's a rapidly growing process. This is called like an avalanche or an electron avalanche. You can think of how the snow as it's falling down the hill is gaining energy from the gravitational field. So in this case, the electrons are gaining energy from the electric field. And this leads to a spark, a breakdown. So you recognize if you have a spark in air, in ambient air, it's about 26 kilovolts per centimeter can cause that breakdown. That's basically what a spark is. And you can make all kinds of sparks. Now we can look at this same process in a different manner. And we can look at two electrodes here, a cathode and an anode. And as we apply that voltage, we produce the so-called primary avalanche. So the negative ions, the electrons are moving much faster. They're smaller and they move much faster towards the anode, leaving behind these positive ions. But the positive ions will also emit photons that could create what's called a secondary avalanche. These again produce another avalanche that's flowing. So these secondary avalanches collide and produce this plasma region around the electrode, and it builds backwards. And as it builds backwards, it makes this streamer. And if you go long enough, you can produce a very high temperature arc between two electrodes. So that's like how a welding arc works. So you have this high energy, high temperature arc. Well, that's not what we want for a chemical reaction. So like I said before, we don't want to have a high temperature process. We want to lower the temperature. And so we want to control that arc. And so there are three ways to control the arc. We want to prevent arcing across the electrode because it releases a lot of heat and makes the chemistry inefficient. And so there are three ways to do that. The first way is to coat the arc with what's called a dielectric. It's a material that doesn't conduct. And you can use different kinds of materials. Alumina is one, silica, other kinds of dielectric materials, like glass even. So they're coating on the surface of the electrodes, and that prevents and stabilizes the arc. Another way is to make a short pulse. So instead of having a high, long pulse that allows you to make that arc, you limit the amount of energy by using a pulse. This is one that we're going to use a lot. I'll talk about that, limiting the pulse. A third way is by flow, and you can stabilize a discharge by high velocity flow. We used to do a lot of work with what's called a gliding arc, and this is like a knife edge. You have a high velocity gas flowing through, and that stabilizes, keeps it from forming that arc. So there are a lot of applications commercially about these kind of plasmas already. The ozone synthesis is a big market for water treatment. Coal gas, a power plant cleanup is another big market. Incinerators using plasmas and biogas treatment as well. Indoor air, there's a wide range of indoor air cleaners that use non-thermal plasma for cleaning. But our focus, like I said, is for water. Now we used to do a lot of work underwater discharge, but over the years we've taken our plasma, this is an electrode underwater, making a discharge. Over the years, we've made a wide variety of reactors, and this is the one I'm going to focus on later. And we've also scale up and work on making bigger reactors to do this. So again, back to the nitrogen splitting, then the idea is we want the energy from electrons, from the radiation from heat to split the nitrogen. the nitrogen as well as the oxygen. Nitrogen will combine with oxygen to make NO. And then we combine the water. This is why the water is important, because we have another compound reactive species called a radical, the OH radical, which takes the nitrogen oxide and converts it into the nitrate and nitrite, which are the species we want for the fertilizer. And they all get then dissolved in water. I'm gonna skip a couple of slides just because we're running a little bit slow. And I'll just go and talk about our reactor. So we're using a reactor that's a quartz cell with two electrodes connected to a power supply. And that produces a water gas system. So you can see in this system, we have you can see the plasma channel that propagates along the surface. And if you do a long-term photographic image, you can see how it fills up the reactor. A single plasma is just formed here, like the single plasma from a lightning storm. So we like to call this like lightning in a bottle. So we're using lightning in a bottle with water to make the species we're interested in. So we've done a lot of studies. I won't talk a lot about this here. We've done a lot of studies to characterize this reactor so we can build more. But what we're doing ultimately then is coming back here is the comparison. So we started out with this idea that lightning, which is a natural phenomena, it actually produces a lot of nitrogen that's emitted into the atmosphere, into the environment each year. And it's just using air and water. But it's a very high energy process. And of course, it's a natural process. Then we talk about this industrial arc process that also had a high temperature process, and the energy efficiency was maybe not as high. And then we talk about this other process, which is not an arc-based or plasma-based, but just a catalyst-based, but it involves a high temperature and a high pressure, and is now responsible for half of the nitrogen used by people in the world today. A large amount of our fertilizers. Now, what we're doing is we're trying to scale the whole thing down. So this is, you can see, working at 700 Kelvin at 200 atmospheres. Our reactor, while it's small, it only functions, now this 300 to 600 Kelvin depends upon which gas we're using, but that's actually the gas in the plasma, but the surrounding, this gas that's flowing is actually ambient temperature. The plasma itself has high energy electrons, but we're not heating up all the gas. Unlike the Haber-Bosch process, where the entire gas is heated at 700 Kelvin, and the entire system is pressurized to 200 atmospheres. This process, like I said before, is really only efficient in very, very large scale factories. But this one we can do in our lab. We can do a very small scale, and we can scale it up as well. But it also works very close to atmospheric pressure, and it only uses air and water. It's more like the lightning, where it's just air and water, whereas this one has to use natural gas to give the hydrogen for the ammonia. And this system is smaller scale, and it's basically it can be controlled by a solar power. So just as a kind of summary of where we started, the lagoon plants, which of course, these are just plants, they work at ambient temperature and pressure. They just use air and water, and they're of course solar powered. And they're also the natural source of nitrogen. You can see that's actually fairly similar to the amount of nitrogen that's produced by the Haber-Bosch process by the lagoons. So this is what we're working on. We're continuing to refine our reactor. We're actually commercializing this, working on commercializing this process now with partners. And the energy cost now is actually competitive for what's called organic foods, because the nitrogen for organic foods, they can't take it from this Haber-Bosch. That's synthetic nitrogen, and organic foods, they don't want synthetic nitrogen. we're still trying to convince them that this is basically a quote unquote organic process, because we could at least call it environmentally friendly because we're only using air and water. And it produces a dilute solution of this nitrates and nitrites, which actually have already been shown to have significant effect on plant growth. This is like a regular nitrogen fertilizer. So this is just some pictures of our prototypes. And I want to finish with one slide. This came from my collaborator, Professor Mark Kushner, who is a professor of electrical, chemical, and mechanical engineering at the University of Michigan. He's one of the leaders in plasma processing, particularly in the microelectronics field. And for those who may be familiar with a concept called Moore's Law, Moore's Law basically is projecting how our computers, the number of transistors, this is the number of transistors that are put on a computer chip versus time. And that you can see from the 70s, actually it could go back further, but from the 70s all the way till now, it follows this straight line on this semi-log graph. And that's basically Moore's law predicting this line is a straight line. Moore was actually the founder of Intel, and one of the founders of Intel, and he elucidated this Moore's law. But the point of this slide is that back in about 1985, which is pointed out here, this is when plasma processing started to play a role in the production of microelectronics circuits. And so you can see that the plasma process actually enabled the high level of production of computer chips and to continue the Moore's law during this time period. So what's this is inspiring is that we're only at the very beginning of utilizing plasma as a chemical process, other than, let's say, the ozone generators, which have been around for 100 years, but using this plasma process for other chemistry. So this is actually a chemical process, but it's not a, let's say, environmental process. It's a chemical process by in plasma processing. One thing I would mention is that many of my students who did PhDs in chemical engineering now work for Intel and in this kind of plasma processing. So just as a final slide, I will say my recent collaborators and students are listed here. Robert Wandell, some of you will get to know very well because he's now teaching in our department. He started out as an undergraduate in honors in my group, and he stayed on for his PhD, his postdoc, and now we hired him as a faculty member. So he's teaching a number of our undergraduate courses. So you'll have a chance to meet him. Some of you might take classes from Professor Alabugan in chemistry or Professor Tang, who's civil environmental engineering. And so these are some of my other collaborators. Also, these are some of the undergraduates who've done honors in the major and just URP on these various projects. And that's basically all I wanted to say. So I'll be glad to answer any questions you have. I didn't put everybody to sleep.
Dr. Locke, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I'm having trouble with my computer, so I had to log in on my phone also. I think let's do the questions a little bit differently today because I can't see the chat reliably. Okay. So if you have a question, if you guys would just unmute yourself and ask Dr. Locke the question.
So I'm like newer to the campus. I'm kind of wondering how exactly I would get involved with undergraduate research. I'm technically a sophomore doing my credit hours, but other than that, I don't really know.
Okay, so the first step to do is to go to our webpage here. So this is the College of Engineering, CBE, and you can go to the link about undergraduate and then URP program. So URP means undergraduate research program. This is your first step. If you're a chemical engineer, if you're not a chemical or biomedical
engineer. Yes, I'm a chemical engineer.
Okay, then you can go to different departments and they will have links, I'm sure. So first step is to go here and you can read about some of this. Now, not all this detail is important to you right now because you're just starting. Most of the detail here is important if you're going to do honors in a major or even for credit undergraduate research. So I just mentioned that the honors in the major has a GPA requirement and you have to apply for it and be approved, as well as the undergraduate research program where you're getting actual academic credit for that. So typically the honors in the major and the URP program, there's 2-3 hour courses you would sign up for, and typically in your junior and usually or senior year, sometimes in the summer between junior and senior year. But you actually get credit for 2-3 hour courses, and those substitute for technical electives. So that's a little bit farther down the road, but I just want to mention that as something to think about as you go forward to plan ahead. At the current stage, what you really want to do is look at the different projects that the faculty have. And so what I suggest you do is you look at these projects. You can look at the individual titles. Maybe they don't mean a lot to you right now. But you can look at the general areas that people work in. So, for example, if you're more interested in biomedical type projects or materials or chemical engineering, you can look at which faculty are more or less in those areas. And then you can come to the list and see, are they interested in undergraduate students? So this list is basically the list of faculty interested in working with undergraduate students. I think it's everybody, but maybe there's some missing, I don't know. But I think everybody is more or less interested. The question will be at your stage, whether they want to take on a freshman or in your case, sophomore. But for us, if you're not yet into the chemical engineering sophomore classes or biomedical engineering sophomore classes, essentially you're like a freshman, don't have a lot of experience. Some of the faculty don't really want to take a student that doesn't have some of our first courses. And some faculty would want to make sure if you're like a bio, are you taking what courses and what lab skills have you already obtained? But this is where at your stage, you can look at this list. You can kind of go to the faculty webpage, their individual webpages, and look at what they're doing. And then just send them an email. Say, I'm interested in potential research project. Do you have any openings in your lab? Just tell them your background and just get started there. Does that answer your question?
Yes, but one more thing. When would I be expected to do the honors for the major?
Yeah, okay. So there are deadlines for the honors in the major. You would need to apply for that. There are specific deadlines to submit the paperwork that has to be done. Now, typically, again, a course has to be created for you for a 3-hour honors in the major, specifically for you with your professor. And these things have to be arranged ahead of time. You have to work with the professor and decide on the topic. You have to write a plan of what you're going to do. It has to be approved. And so you want to start early enough. Now, my own experience, and I've supervised, 17 or 18 honors in the major students, but typically for me, I tried to recruit my honors in the major students in the spring of their junior year, sometimes in the fall of junior year. And now actually the students I have are all starting. They started in the summer of their sophomore year. I have had some start earlier, but it's the fall of the junior year is often a very difficult semester to get a lot of research done because the classes are hard and there's a very intensive class program. So typically you might start working with a faculty in the spring of your junior year, but the actual application for the honors and the major would start, maybe you could start working on it by the end of the spring. And if you're gonna do it in the summer or come back in the fall, it would all be ready. But the deadlines and the process are all outlined on the webpage, but Earlier is better, but too early is probably not useful. So I would recommend fall of junior year to really get serious about it, at least in the planning stage. Does that help?
Yes, thank you.
Other questions? So while you guys are thinking of questions, I will say, so I have the students that are now working in my lab, undergraduate students, they're all juniors in chemical engineering. One student is, we collaborate with Professor Yoneng Tang, who's the civil environmental engineering. One of the students we're working together on, the student is a chemical engineer, but we're working together. They are all working in the lab. Well, except for one, they're all working in the lab. One of the students is doing computer modeling. And they also tend to work with the graduate student who's kind of supervising the lab work. They all have individual projects. And another avenue for student research support. So if a faculty member has a grant from the National Science Foundation, they can apply for what's called a research experience for undergraduates. It's a special monetary award that can be used to help support an undergraduate to work on research project. And I get those all the time. Most of our faculty who have NSF grants would also get those as supplements. There are also, the MagLab also has what's called a research experience for undergraduate program that you can apply for in the summer. And I don't have the details here. You have to look at their webpage. Dr. Grant could help you if you wanted more to know about that. Dr. Grant is our faculty member who works in the MagLab. He does the MRI and the biomedical imaging side. But they also have other opportunities in the MagLab for research. Other questions?
Remember, I'm putting all these links in the chat. Remember, if you have any questions for Dr. Locke, please just unmute yourself and ask your question.
Oh, I have another question. Does the university have like a hydroponics or any like garden type where you guys mess with the fertilizers?
We're not, our particular group is not working with that. But there are some biology professors who work, they have a lab on the top floor of the biology building at FSU, but there's also a big agricultural group at FAMU as well. Because we're really focusing on the chemical side, we're not doing those plant tests. There's a lot of other people who do that. And it's already been shown that in our case, for our system, the materials that we produce are already beneficial as a fertilizer. So we're not doing that. But there are groups at FAMU and FSU who do agricultural work. It's more biology than engineering. But there is a biological and agricultural systems engineering program at FAMU as well.
I was just wondering. Thank you.
Okay, are there any more questions for Dr. Locke?
I have a question. So of all the students, are you all chemical and biomedical engineering students? Is anybody not? It's hard to get a reaction, isn't it? Okay. Anyway, if you all have other questions, feel free. You can send me an email anytime, and I'll try to help you out.
Okay. Well, I'm gonna put Dr. Lee's profile link so they can get in touch with her if they have questions about the undergraduate research program at CBE. And remember that this is going to be recorded and made available on our website. So if you have any other questions, this is your last chance to ask them, or you can contact the Department of Chemical and Biomedical Engineering and get to Dr. Locke that way.
Is it possible if we can get Dr. Locke's email or any type of information?
Dr. Locke, can you put your email in the chat?
Yeah, okay. I can find it. Where'd it go?
Okay.
Well, it's very simple. It's just Locke, L-O-C-K-E. At eng.famu.fsu.edu. Oh. I lost the chat. Oh.
Okay, I put that in the chat for
okay.
you.
Okay, good. I got. Thank you.
Yeah.
I finally
okay.
got
it. All right, got it. Okay, well, thank you, everyone. Thank you so much, Dr. Locke. We appreciate your time.
Welcome.
Thank you. And remember, everyone, that that the best thing to do if you want to find a research opportunity is to go to your department. You can contact them via email, or you can go down there and walk in and talk to them. And the chair of your department will point you in the right direction. Thank you so much, everyone. Have a great evening.